today are the 24 colors of Lisa Horton Interference Reinkers that match the pads we began to stock several months ago. Reinkers can be used for a lot more than just adding juicy color back to your pads, and in today's video, I'll show you a couple of techniques for doing just that. Links to the products can be found in the expanded description below. These ink pads have been a pretty big hit since we introduced them several months ago, and now each of the 24 colors of pads has a matching reinker. Remember, these are interference colors that are going to appear different on black than they do on white or light, and that's why you see two colors here on the pad labels. It's showing you this is the main color that you'll see on white, and this is the interference color that you'll see on dark. So if I kind of slide these out of the way, I'm going to bring in my swatches because I keep these always. They are a good reference point to come back to, and you can see the difference. So for example, this is Tropical Paradise. When you look at it, it's quite purple here on the black, but when you look at it on the pink, on the white, it's very obviously pink. When you look at Opal Blush, you can see you've got this kind of pinky purpley color going on here, and you've got blue. So these are a great reference. I take the time to make them, I come back and I use them quite often. Reinkers, well duh, are meant to add juicy color back to a pad that needs refreshing. But thinking outside the box, and I'm laying these down deliberately because I want the color to remain more or less suspended, and by leaving them on their side, they're not going to pool at the bottom like they would like this. So these are, as I said, meant to refresh an ink pad, but given what their purpose is to refresh that pad, the color is far more concentrated in this bottle than it would be if I just went and I swiped the pad on my nonstick craft sheet. With the reinker, I can control the depth of color by how many dots I use, and then by how much water I add, I can control how deep those colors are going to be, and then I can mix colors. So before I show you Dip and Dab, if I can find my samples, here are a couple of sets of samples that I played with. So this set, and I've written on the back, this is Golden Sun, Lavender Fields, and Cherry Bomb. And you can see how different they look, and I'm going to hold these up. You can see how different they are depending on the background color. Here, you see the color of that dye ink that is the liquid because it's a light surface. And here you see varying degrees of that because you can see some of the light color here, but it's almost non-existent on the black because that's a function of the way these interference colors work. This set is Crushed Velvet, Fruit Salad, and Sweet Treat. Again, you see all those colors here on the white, but when you bring in the craft, you see less, and when you bring in the black, really what you see is the mica, the interference color that's in there. So, as I mentioned, you do have to shake the bejesus out of these bottles. So I have four colors here, and I've already pre-shaken them. Sometimes when you shake them, if you don't hear that mixing ball moving around, you might have to tap this. You might have to turn it up and tap it like this to get that mixing ball loosened up from all of the pigment and the mica that's in there. You obviously want to distribute all of that, because if you're going to reink a pad, you want to get all of the stuff, whether it's the color or the mica, back into that pad. So you're going to shake, 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 and do what you need to do. And so these four colors, I'm going to start with these three. I'm going to bring in the green if I need to. I have Mermaid Lagoon, Fruit Salad, and Pink Champagne. And I'm simply going to drop some on my surface. Again, nonstick craft sheet, so really easy to do. And then I'm going to put some water in, and then I'll dip and dab. And I've got the same three surfaces. I've got craft, watercolor, and black that I'm going to dip and dab on. I just happen to have index cards rather than, those are oval disc-bound pages. All right, so let's put some water on here. And again, I'm gonna control how thin the color gets, how watered down that color gets, based on how much water I put down. And that's always a choice that you make kind of as you go along. All right, so here we go. I've got craft first. I'm gonna dip and dab. And that's really, really pretty. Now, the thing with these is you don't see the mica quite so much until they dry. Now, this is very watercolor-like because I put a fair amount of water in there. So I'm going to do the same thing here. Now, you'll notice that these colors do start to mix on the table a little bit. And that's okay. That's not a problem at all. It's just a function of what you do. So I'm going to pause the video for 1 second. I'm going to go off to the side and I'm going to dry these so you can see what they look like. And more especially because I want to put another layer on. When I dip and dab, it's very common for me to dry and then add a second and sometimes a third layer depending on how much stuff I've got left on my table. So give me a second to do that and then I'll come back and I'll show you. So here are my three samples with their original dip and dab colors dried, and now what I'm going to do is come back and I'm going to put another layer on each of them. And this just builds up the color, it builds up the mica, and do you have to? Absolutely not. It really, as I said a moment ago, it's a preference, how much stuff I've got left on my table, and whether or not I'm super satisfied with what I've already done, and if I don't want to add to it, then I won't. But I really like this technique. It allows lots of different freedom, lots of different kinds of freedoms rather, and that I always am very happy with. I like this kind of splotchy look that I get. The technique I'm going to show you next tends to result in something that's a little bit more blended, but it's always nice to have options. So here's basically where I am, and obviously these colors will be, the mica will be much more evident once everything is fully dry. But let me put these to one side, I'll clean up, and then I'll come back and I'll show you this other technique where we're going to start with a wet surface and add the reinker to it. I have my surfaces ready to go. Again, a craft, a watercolor, and a black, and I have three colors, and I've already shaken these. So I have Cherry Bomb, Golden Sun, and Lavender Field. And what I'm going to do, now doing three at a time can be a little bit difficult to control only because these are going to want to bend a little bit with the water, but it's just part and parcel of this. So I'm going to add some drops of each of these to my wet surfaces. And so I'm going to go ahead and obviously how much water I put on here, I don't know what that smudge is, I don't even have a dog. How much water I put on here is going to affect how much the color moves. I think I need more. I can either put it on now or I can put it on afterward. So starting with Lavender Field, you can see here where there's a lot of water on that spot right there, I'm going to get a fair amount of blooming, and here it's going to be less. But we can come back after the fact and add water, and that's always a really good option. Now this is really absorb the color, so the water rather, so I'm going to put a little bit more on. This Golden Sun is a pretty amazing color when you use it this way. Alright. Cherry Bomb, so pretty. I love this. Really pretty color. Now, again, it really doesn't make all that much difference if these are not super wet at the time, although it's better if you can start with them because then you've already got your color movement happening. Just get a piece of paper towel here. Alright, so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to start adding water, and how much more water I add will really affect how much blooming and spreading of color that you get. So I'm going to come back with a little bit more Lavender Field here because I didn't get as much as I wanted, and this is really the fun part. Now I can play and do what I want in terms of trying to achieve a certain look. And if I want to leave these alone, I can leave that color, well, except for right there where the dot didn't bloom at all, I can leave that color pretty condensed, which is probably what I'm going to do. Now, the one thing that you'll notice is that these are, obviously, they're bending a little bit. And let me show you something interesting that I did with this last one. This is a piece of paper towel. This is actually one ply of a paper towel that I was using to pick up the kind of things that are happening here. So if I come in and I start sopping up this color along the edges, that kind of happens, and you do this enough times, eventually you get a piece of paper towel that's completely saturated with color, and you can even see the shimmer on there. And I pulled this apart, and I went ahead and I'll figure out something to do with that. But when you do this, and I've got some of these done, put to one side here someplace that I need to put my hands on. I know I had them a minute ago because I wanted to show you the finished samples. What the heck did I do with them? Oh, yeah. All right, so give me 1 second and I will find those samples and then I'll come back and I will show you what you can kind of expect this to look like once it dries. It only took 5 minutes to find them because I'd put them in such a safe place. But here are the original samples that I made using those three colors when we're talking about Lavender Field, Copper Sun, and Cherry Bomb. I used more water here. I kind of worked on them one at a time to keep them more flat, and I got this more of a blended look, which again is pretty different than that look that you get with Dip and Dab. So you, this is the thing about these reinkers. Not only are they great for what I've just shown you and reinking your pad, but there are lots of other types of techniques that you can use with reinkers. You could spread out some shaving cream, not the gel stuff. It's got to be the foam stuff. Spread it out nice and smooth. Put some dots on there, and then you swirl it with a skewer or whatever, and you go ahead and turn your paper face down, and you go ahead and press, and then you let it sit for a minute, take and scrape with an old room card or a credit card, scrape the foam off, and you have a whole different look and pattern that gets formed there. The other thing you can do is grab an acrylic block, put some drops on it, put some water on it, and then squish it. So, you know, with these reinkers, there's lots of different possibilities for all of the ways that you can use them, in addition to the regular stuff like re-inking your pad with them.